Welcome class 12th, here we are going to begin chapter 2nd, The Tiger King, from your Vista's textbook. Let's know about the author of this story. Ramaswamy Iyer Krishnamurti, better known by his pen name Kalki. He was the famous Indian writer, journalist, poet, critic and independence activist. He was named after Kalki, the 10th and last avatar of the Hindu god Vishnu. His writings include over 120 short stories, novels, historical romances, editorial and political writings, and hundreds of films and music reviews. Let's discuss about the theme of the story. The Tiger King is a satire on the pride and stubbornness of the people in power. Here the writer takes us to the days of autocratic and eccentric kings who lived under the thumb rule of the British and feared them. Most of the time, rulers were not interested in serving the people and working for the welfare of the public. Instead, they spent their time in the foolish pursuits. The author has here commented about how animals and birds, as much as part of human beings. In the first part of the story, you will come to know about the astrologers' prediction and miracle related to the Tiger King. So let's see. The Maharaja of Pratibhanpuram is the hero of the story. He may be identified as His Highness Jamidar General Kheledar Major Satyavyagra Samahari Maharaja Dhiraj Vishwabhuman Samrat Sir Jilani Jang Jang Bahadur MAD ACTC or CR. But this name is often shortened to the Tiger King. So the writer introduces the main character of the story, that is the King of Pratibhanpuram. He has been given the list of these titles of His Highness Jamidar General, Kheledar Major, Satyavyagra, Maharaja Adhiraj or Samrat, Sir Jilani Jang Jang Bahadur. So all these titles have been given to emphasize about the greatness and bravery of this king. Sum up all in one, the king has been called the Tiger King. I have come forward to tell you why he came to known as Tiger King. The author here tells the reader he would let them know why the king was called the Tiger King. I have no intention of pretending to advance, only to end in a strategic withdrawal. He said, if I have made the promise with you to let you know the reason, then I am not going to make any planned withdrawal. That means any policy to quit from this promise. Even the threat of Stuka bomber will not throw me off track. Stuka bomber, this is a German bomber aircraft that was used during the Second World War. He said, right at the start, it is imperative to disclose a matter of vital importance about the Tiger King. Imperative, that means urgent or important. Everyone who reads of him will experience the natural desire to meet a man of his indomitable courage face to face. Indomitable, that means dauntless or undefeatable. So here the author comments that if you will come to know about the qualities of the dauntless courage of this Tiger King, you will feel the natural desire to meet such great man face to face. But there is no chance of its fulfillment. But he said, your wish would never be fulfilled. As Bharat, the manner of his death is a matter of extraordinary interest. It can be revealed only at the end of a tale. Tale means story. The most fantastic aspect of his demise was that as soon as he was born, astrologers had foretold that one day the Tiger King would actually have to die. So demise here means death. So foretold, that means predict. So the author here says that the manner of the death of this Tiger King is really fantastic, and only at the end of story you would come to know. But the most fantastic thing was that when This great king was born. The astrologers, they made the prediction that one day this tiger king would die. At that very moment, a great miracle took place. An astonishing phrase emerged from the lips of 10 days old Jilani Changchang Bahadur. Astonishing means surprising. Wise prophets, everyone stood transfixed in stupefaction. Transfixed means motionless. Stupefaction, that means astonishment. They looked wildly at each other. So suddenly, a miracle took place. The baby, who was just 10 days old, he began to speak and he was addressing the prophets. Prophets, the saints. Prophets here means the astrologers. So they couldn't believe and started now blinking their eyes. Oh, wise prophets, it was I who spoke. This time there was no ground for doubt. It was the infant born just 10 days ago who had enunciated the words so clearly. Enunciated, that means produce. So they couldn't believe that just 10 days old baby was producing these words. So as he said, that it was he who was speaking. All those who are born will one have to die. We don't need your prediction to know that. There would be some sense in it if you could tell us the manner of that death. The royal infant uttered these words in his little squeaky voice. Squeaky, that means very sharp and shrilly sound. So here, this 10 days old baby, he asked the question to the astrologers. So what is different here if you said that would be the sense in your talk, in your prediction, if you would tell me the manner of my death? The chief astrologer placed his finger on his nose in wonder. The chief astrologer took the finger off his nose and fixed his eyes upon the little prince. The prince was born in the hour of the bull. The bull and the tiger are enemies. Therefore, death comes from the tiger, he explained. So, he explained to the little prince as he was born in the hour of the bull. The bull and the tiger are both enemies. So his death would come from the tiger side. So he has to be careful from the tigers in this world. You may think that Crown Prince Changchang Bahadur was thrown into a quack. Quack means to tremble with fear when he heard the word tiger. So what do you feel? The small prince, he would get scared about the prediction of his death. This is what not happened. As soon as he heard it pronounced, the crown prince gave a deep growl. Growl is a threatening sound. But instead, he gave the threat to the tigers of the world. Terrifying words emerged from his lips. So very terrifying, very frightful words appeared from this small baby. Let tigers beware. Instead of fearing, the small prince gave the threat to all the wild tigers of the world. Be careful, I am in this life. This account is only a rumor rife in Pradibandpuram. So about this miracle, this may be the rumor spread during the time of his birth. But with hindsight, we may conclude it was based on some truth. But the writer says this may be the rumor spread about his birth time prediction. But there would be surely some truth lying in this now story. Crown Prince Changchang Bahadur grew taller and stronger day by day. No other miracle marked his childhood days apart from the event already described. So here in this part, you will come to know about the upbringing of this Crown Prince. So here it is told, the Crown Prince grew taller and stronger day by day. But nothing else happened except that miracle of his birth time. In his childhood days, the boy drank the milk of an English cow, was brought up by the English nanny. Nanny is the caretaker, tutored in English by an Englishman, saw nothing but English films, exactly the crown princes of all the other Indian states did. So there was a very royal treatment in his upbringing. So like other princes in India, the crown prince, he also drank the milk of the English cow, was looked after by the English nanny and tutored by only English teacher. And he saw nothing but only the English movies in his life. When he came of age at 20, the state which had been with a court of wards until then came into his hands. Then he was crowned the king at the age of 20. But everyone in the kingdom remembered the astrologer's prediction. Many continued to discuss the matter. Slowly it came to the Maharaja's ear. When he came of age at 20, the state which had been with a court of wards until then came into his hands. Then he was crowned the king at the age of 20. But everyone in the kingdom remembered the astrologer's prediction. Many continued to discuss the matter. Slowly it came to the Maharaja's ears. Slowly it came to the Maharaja's ears. So he also come to about death prediction. There were innumerable forests in Pratibhanpuram state with tigers in them. Maharaja knew old saying, you may kill even a cow in self-defense. There could be certainly be no objection to killing tigers in self-defense. The Maharaja started out on a hunt. There were many forests in Pratibhanpuram state. There are tigers also in them. He started out the tiger hunt thinking that in their religion, if it is permitted to kill the cow in the self-defense, then there would be no objection to kill the tigers in the self-protection. So thinking of this, he now started his now mission of killing the tigers. The Maharaja was thrilled beyond measure. When he killed his first tiger, he sent for the state astrologer and showed him the dead beast. So after killing the first tiger, he called the same astrologer who had made the prediction about his death from the tiger. What do you say now? He demanded. He asked that, what is your reply? Your majesty may kill 99 tigers in exactly the same manner. But the astrologer drawled. Drawled here means to hold the tongue. The astrologer replied that the king could kill 99 tigers exactly the way he did that day. But after this, he drawled his tongue. When the king compelled him to speak the truth, he explained that he had to be careful from the 100th tiger that was going to take his life. Again at his prediction, the king challenged and said if he would kill the 100th tiger too. And then I will tear up all my books on astrology, set fire to them, and I shall cut off my tuft from my hair short and become an insurance agent. The astrologer finished on an incoherent note. Incoherent, that means unkind or unclear. So very now, roughly, the astrologer replied that he would tear all his books of astrology and set them on fire. He continued that he was also going to cut off his hair and tuft and would surely change his profession from astrologer to an insurance agent if his prediction would go wrong. That day onwards, it was celebration time for all the tigers inhabiting Pratibhanpuram. The state banned tiger hunting by anyone except the Maharaja. A proclamation was issued to the fact that if anyone dared to flinch so much as a stone at a tiger, all his wealth and property would be confiscated. Proclamation, that is the official declaration. Flinch means throw. Confiscated, that means taken with authority. So from that day onwards, the tigers in Pratibhanpuram had a very nice time. As the kingdom had banned the tiger hunting by anyone except the Maharaja. So the tiger felt safe that if the king would come in the forest, then only their life would be at stake. No one was now allowed to kill a tiger other than the Maharaja now. The law was so strict that an official announcement was made that if anyone would be caught killing a tiger or even throwing a stone at a tiger, his whole wealth and property would be confiscated by the kingdom of Pratibhanpuram. Not that he faced no dangers. There were times when the bullet missed its mark. The tiger leapt upon him and he fought the beast with his bare hands. Each time it was the Maharaja who won. So leapt means jump. Bare hands, that means empty handed. So don't think the king didn't have to face dangers during these hunting expeditions. Sometimes
His bullet missed the mark and the tiger jumped upon him. And other time when he fought with the tiger, he had to fight barehanded. But each time it was the Maharaja who won and killed the tiger. At another time, he was in danger of losing his throne. A high-ranking British officer visited Pratibandhapuram. He was very fond of hunting tigers and fonder of being photographed with the tigers he had shot. As usual, he wished to hunt tigers in Pratibandhapuram. But the Maharaja was firm in his resolve. He refused permission. "I can organize any other hunt. You may go on a boar hunt. You may conduct a mouse hunt, be ready for a mosquito hunt. But tiger hunt, that is impossible." So here, firm means determined. Resolve, that means to take oath. Boar stands for pig. So here, the writer tells another instance when this tiger king, he was about to lose his kingdom. So when a high-ranking British officer visited his state, that man was fond of hunting the tigers. He wanted to get himself photographed with the dead tigers. So he wanted to hunt tigers in his state. But as the Maharaja had banned the hunting tiger by anyone else, he even did not give permission to this British officer too. He sent him the message that you can go on any other hunting. Like, he could go on the pig hunt, he could also go on the mouse hunt, but he said he was also ready to arrange the mosquito hunt for him. But tiger hunt, he said, could never. So he refused to arrange the tiger hunting for this British officer. The British officer's secretary sent word to the Maharaja through the Diwan that Durai himself did not have to kill the tiger. The Maharaja could do the actual killing. What was important to Durai was a photograph of himself holding the gun and standing over the tiger's carcass. But the Maharaja would not agree even to this proposal. If he relented now, what would he do if other British officers turned up for the tiger hunts? Durai stand for the British senior officer, and carcass, that is the dead animal's body. British officer's secretary sent a message to Maharaja that Durai did not want to kill the tiger by himself. The king could do the actual hunting. He only want to get himself photographed with the dead body of the tiger. But the king did not agree to this proposal. He thought if he would allow the officer to get himself photographed this way, then the other British officer would also come to his state in order to fulfill their wish of hunting the tiger deer. Because he prevented a British officer from fulfilling his desire, the Maharaja stood in danger of losing his kingdom itself. The Maharaja and Diwan had deliberation over this issue. As a result, a telegram was dispatched forthwith to a famous British company of jewelers in Calcutta. Sent samples of expensive diamond rings of different deliberations, that means discussions. As the king had refused to fulfill the desire of a British officer, he was now in danger of losing his kingdom. Then the king had discussion with his Diwan over the issue. The king sent his telegram to a famous British company of jewelers based in Calcutta. He asked them to send some samples of expensive diamond rings of different designs. Some 50 rings arrived. The Maharaja sent the whole lot to the British officer's good lady. The king and his minister expected the Durai Sahni to choose one or two rings and send the rest back. Within no time at all, Durai Sahni sent a reply, "Thank you very much for your gifts." In 2 days, a bill for 3 lakh rupees came from the British jewelers. The Maharaja was happy that though he had lost 3 lakh rupees, he had managed to retain his kingdom. Duraisani, that means the wife of the British officer. Retain means to restore or save. The jeweler sent 50 rings and the Maharaja sent this whole lot to the British officer's wife. He was expecting that the lady would choose one or two rings and return the others back. But very surprisingly, she sent only the message of thanks and kept all the rings with her. After 2 days, the king got the bill of 3 lakh rupees for the 50 diamond rings from the company. The Maharaja was happy as he was able to save his kingdom, though he had the loss of 3 lakh rupees at all.